Welcome to What's Cooking. There's one seat left just for you. Today's class focuses on cooking light, or how could so many things that taste so good be good for you too. We're going to start out with marinated chicken breasts, lime chicken breasts, and I'm going to assemble some ingredients, and we're going to marinate the chicken breasts for a little while and then broil them. The secret to this recipe is fresh ingredients, fresh ingredients, fresh ingredients. I can't emphasize that enough. So I'm going to combine some ingredients here, and John is going to juice some fresh limes. We're using olive oil as our oil mixture, the juice of three limes, some cilantro, which I'll talk about a little bit later, four cloves of garlic, fresh garlic that have been pressed, a little bit of salt, about a half a teaspoon.
These are tough limes this morning.
Are they? And some freshly ground black pepper. Now, I think he's half joking about the tough limes, but just as a commentary, anytime you juice anything that's citrus in nature, if you have it at room temperature, you'll get maximum amount of juice from it, and it'll be a lot easier to juice for you.
You had these in the refrigerator just to make it tough for me.
Right.
Now I know why they're tough.
One of the good things to take advantage of is when limes are on special because they're extra soft or the season is just about winding down. If you can buy a big pack of them, juice them up and stick the juice in your freezer, and it's really handy for this recipe.
There you go.
Thank you, John. How about if you remind the people how to skin and bone a chicken breast? And
alrighty. We're going to take it one step further than we did last week. I am going to skin and bone it again, just kind of refresh you on how to skin and bone a chicken breast. But then we're going to pound it out a little flatter. The first thing you want to do is kind of get oriented. The thick part goes at the top, and the thin part, which is just at this end, skin and
let me get this out of your way.
And bone. Thank you. We're going to cut through the skin there just to give us a place to grab hold of it, and then just tear the skin off. And it comes off quite easily. And then we'll go along this fat line and very gently pull the meat back away from the rib cage. There's two parts to the chicken breast, the heavy part and the tenderloin. I'm going to take it apart and separate. I'm going to take it apart as one and then separate it so you can see. Cut it away from the. Now this is the half a wishbone. I'm just going to cut along that.
Is that if you want to just make half a wish?
That's correct.
Okay.
Now, here's the whole chicken breast. If I turn it over, you'll see the tenderloin comes out quite easily. And at this point, we'll put it between two pieces of wax paper and use a meat pounder to pound it out. The tenderloin, which is up front, will hit gently. And we're just trying to go about 50% bigger than it was. Now, in the case of the large, thick piece, that's a little tougher, so we're going to have to pound.
Keep your fingers out of the way.
Right. And that's all there is to it.
The purpose of doing the pounding for this particular recipe is that the chicken cooks uniformly. You're not tenderizing the chicken, obviously, because it's already tender enough.
It's all set to be marinated.
Okay, we're going to pour this over. Turn it a little bit.
You're coating both sides?
Right.
That looks good enough to eat already almost, doesn't it?
Sure does. Okay, we'll refrigerate that for a few minutes.
I'll just put it over here in the cooler until we're ready to broil it.
Now, John had some skin and bones here a few minutes ago. from doing the chicken. And what you could do is take that and stick it in your freezer until you have some extra time, and you can make chicken stock out of that. Put that in a pot, put some water over it, enough to cover it about an inch, and just let it cook down on your stovetop for an hour or longer, depending on how concentrated you want it, and then simply strain it well and stick it in your freezer in one cup capacity or anything like that. It makes great chicken stock. The skin and bone of chickens make the greatest stock. Okay, a spicy mixed bean salad. This is so easy to make, it's a little bit sinful, so we'll go ahead and assemble this. I'm using butter beans for this, which are similar to lima beans, and I'll get those out. And a can of spicy chili beans, and a can of dark red kidney beans. And just to start, we're going to combine these three.
Under which bowl is the pea?
There's one that's very drippy. Thank you. Let me talk for a little bit about the dressing that goes with this. We're going to use a combination of red wine vinegar, which is wonderful for salad dressings also. And we're going to use canola oil, since this is a cooking light class. Canola oil is 94% saturated fat free, and it has a very light flavor to it, so we're going to use that also. We're going to use chopped fresh cilantro. Now, if you're not familiar with this, it's available anymore on a regular basis in produce departments. It looks a lot like, excuse me, flat Italian parsley. It's referred to also as coriander. Coriander traditionally is the seed and cilantro is the leaf. It's used in Mexican cooking, it's used in Chinese cooking, it's even used in Indian cooking. It has a very distinct flavor to it. It's a wonderful herb. Then we're also going to use cumin. And this has a very distinct flavor to it, and it's used a lot in chili powders, in curry powders, but we're going to use it on its own, and some crushed red pepper flakes. And John, I'm also going to need some chopped onion and some pressed garlic. So how about if I turn it over to you?
Okay. Where did our garlic press disappear to? Is it still in the drawer? Okay, I'll show you the way that that I like to cut an onion and dice it. Take off the top and the bottom. This is a flat onion, so it's
a little bit easier.
A little bit easier to do. And then take a little slice on opposite sides, and at that point you can pull off the first layer of skin quite easily. Now, at this point, what I'm going to do is cut it in half and work on a half at a time. First, I'll slice it and kind of hold it together with my fingers. Now I have four slices. I'll turn it and just cut down through the slices, and I have the nice little pieces that I was looking for.
I'm going to take the cilantro. There's a lot of different ways you can chop it up. But first of all, you can also use the stems, but the stems have a stronger flavor to them. And you could take a chef's knife and put them on a cutting board and then chop them. Or you could simply take some kitchen shears, which is what I like to do, and just snip away till you're done. The leaves are pretty big, but for the bean salad, I like it that way.
A lot of times in class, people will ask us, how do you keep an onion from smelling and causing your eyes to water? And the thing that I've found that works the best is just a very sharp knife. Because a dull knife, for some reason, you know, causes more juice to come out, I think, and the aroma comes up from that.
It has a tendency to tear the onion as opposed to just cutting through it.
Right. This is a garlic keeper, and a bulb of garlic, a small bulb of garlic. We're just going to take one clove, show you what a clove looks like, about like that. By the way, the garlic keeper keeps garlic a little bit better than it does in the refrigerator. It has holes in it so that air will circulate, but it keeps it dark inside, and the fact that it's pottery also helps. Now, back to the garlic press. This happens to be the Susie garlic press, which we think is the best. And one of the reasons we like it so much is you don't have to peel the garlic. All you do is put it in.
Have you press it in there.
Squeeze it into, let's get a little knife here, whatever you're squeezing it into. And most of the time, the peel is left on the plunger. Very easy to use garlic press.
This is a great recipe to take with you to a picnic in the summertime, a potluck. It's easy to make. It holds up well in the heat also. And there probably isn't anybody out there that couldn't make this. And the secret to serving this whole meal is to not tell anybody that it's good for them. Because if you remember as a kid, if your parents told you, eat it, it's good for you, you certainly tried to avoid it at all possible costs. Okay, we're going to chill that. Now, we definitely need a dessert to go with this. And we're going to make fresh strawberries because they're just wonderful right now from California. And we're going to make an amaretto yogurt cream to go with it.
While Bev's making that, I'm going to start the chicken broiling. Put it in for about 2 minutes. And then I'll take it out and turn it, and I'll show you what we're looking for as far as how to tell if it's done or not.
This would be a great meal to serve for Mother's Day.
Or any day.
Or any day. Okay, let me start off by just showing you a little bit about strawberries. This is kind of a neat little gadget. Looks like a tweezer, but it's actually a strawberry huller. And the biggest use for it is this, but the point of it is you want maximum strawberry and minimum waste. If you use a knife and you cut your strawberry, you're wasting a lot of the fruit. If you use the huller, you're getting just the hull and saving most of the fruit. So it's really a handy little gadget. And I'm going to put some sugar on these strawberries and let them sit for a few minutes. One of the purposes of doing that is to draw out all the extra juices, sweetening them up just a little bit.
That strawberry huller, by the way, is a tool that's been around for a long, long time. I remember my grandmother using one exactly like that. I think it's like the mousetrap. It hasn't changed in 100 years.
It's a lot more pleasant than the mousetrap.
Yes.
Okay, to go with this, we are going to combine some non-fat vanilla yogurt. And 2 tablespoons of amaretto liqueur. And we want to whisk it up so it's nice and smooth. How long are you cooking that chicken for? About
2 minutes on the side. We're going to cook it 2 minutes on the first side, turn it over, and when I'm turning it over, I'll check to see how much it's done, and I'll judge from there. There it goes.
Okay. I'll give you some room. You can bring it out.
I better have some mitts. Beth, could you hand me my grabbers? Thank you. That's a technical cooking term, grabbers. The little tenderloins are almost done. Now you can see on this side that it's all white. On the other side, it's still a little bit pink. We're looking for all the pink to go away, and we're also trying to catch this meat exactly when it's done so we don't overcook it and it begins to dry out. I think it's going to take the full 2 minutes, but I'll give it about a minute and 30, 45 seconds, and then we'll check it.
This is really attractive in a wine goblet if you serve it like this. I hope nobody thought you were serious about the technical cooking term and the grabbers.
No.
And put some toasted almonds on top. Try not to make a mess.
On the side, so we have a place to.
This looks good enough for breakfast, too, I think.
Should we put some beans on the plate?
Let's put some bean salad on there. Stir it up a little bit before you're ready to serve it. And if you're going to serve it on a plate as opposed to a bowl, it's a good idea to use something that'll strain some of the extra juice.
One of the things that we hope you'll learn from our classes is that good food really doesn't have to take a lot of time. It doesn't have to be complicated in recipes. And again, the secret of good cooking is a good recipe followed by good ingredients. And a little bit of technique sometimes help. A little bit of equipment can sometimes help. The gadgets. There's my oven.
It's wonderful, too, when you can serve something that's this quick and tastes this good and is also healthy for you. It seems to be a bonus. Now, how are you going to tell when that's done?
Okay, I'm going to cut it and take a look inside, and if it's white, pure white all the way through, no longer translucent, it is done. In this case, it is done. Some people would look at this chicken breast and say it's not done because it's not brown on the outside. They make the same mistake with fish, by the way. But this is done perfectly, and it's ready to eat.
You don't want to overcook chicken, just like you don't want to overcook fish. Again, the secret to this class, fresh ingredients, great taste, a clear throat also helps. Excuse me.
Have
for
some
one
water.
Second. I need some of this healthy food. That'll clear me right up. Anyway, that's it for today. Thanks for joining us. Stop in again and find out what's cooking.
For a copy of today's recipes, send a self-addressed stamped envelope marked Number 2, Cooking Light, to What's Cooking, 843 North Cleveland Maslin Road, Akron, Ohio, 44333-2174.
And if you've made it right, you'll know it. It's not like anything you've made before. And if you've made it wrong, you'll know it. 'Cause it won't keep you coming back for more. I didn't get